Good morning, everybody. So my name is Ryan, and I'm the CEO and co-founder of Treehouse. And I live in Portland, Oregon, so it's wonderful to be somewhere with a beachy, happy scene thing going on. So I want to know how many of, like, if any of you ended up sleeping somewhere you didn't mean to, like on the ground or in the gutter? Nobody.
Last night?
Not in general, last night would be good. Nobody, you guys did not drink hard enough. Okay, so I'll ask you another question then. So who went to bed the latest? So let's try this here, okay? Let's say 1 a.m. Raise your hands.
Fuck.
You guys, this is a conference.
Okay, 1? Like 1 a.m. or later? That was better. Okay, 2 a.m. or later?
Bad.
3 a.m. Oh my god. 4 a.m. Okay, 3:30 or later. 3:15. I'm trying to figure out who wins here. Okay. Who? Juan? Who else? Raise your hands high. 3:15 or later. Okay, you guys get free Treehouse accounts for life. So come and grab me afterwards and Okay. So today, this is the main theme of my talk. So I said this once somewhere, and someone amazing drew that for me. And now it's on my wall. But this is kind of the theme of my life. Everyone that has ever accomplished a huge task started knowing absolutely nothing. And I think yesterday, Mike's talk was an amazing example of that. He ended up building a piece of hardware. He didn't know anything about how to do that, and he figured it out. So I hope if you take one thing away from this, that anything that I've done that's any good is not because I'm smart or because I'm, super connected or intelligent or anything. It's just that I am naively optimistic about what's possible. So I kind of assume, hey, anything's possible, and then figure it out later. So real quick, just so you understand what I do and that kind of stuff, I run Treehouse. The idea of Treehouse is an online school. So if you want to, you pick something you want to learn, like front-end web development, and then we put you on a track. It's like going to college, but without all the stupid expense. And so say you want to learn front-end web development, then basically you put you on a track. When you get done, then you're job ready, and then we try to put you in a job. So we just do that with video. We have smart teachers that teach. We have a cloud-based IDE that you can actually write code in. So it's called Workspaces. It's a full-blown text editor with hosting. And then we have code challenges. So, and as you learn, you get points. So that's Treehouse. And we're having a lot of fun doing it. It's my fourth company. So my first company failed. I sold two companies, and now I'm doing Treehouse. So I'm just going to talk about some things that I've learned as along the way. We've got an iPad app too. So again, this is kind of a theme. I hope that you guys can walk away from this knowing that, whether you're a designer at a firm or if you run your own company or you're thinking about doing your own thing, that there's nothing to stop you from doing that. You guys in this and girls in this room are, probably the top 0.1% of the world in wealth and education. And you have every opportunity to succeed. There is nothing that will hold you back. Just look at Ryan. Ryan has no arms and legs, and he figured this out. And you guys are smart. You have expensive Macs. You guys have everything it takes. So I hope that you can walk away from this knowing that there's no reason that you can't do anything that you want to do. And it's not bullshit, it's real. So at Treehouse, we have kind of a weird culture. And I'm going to talk a little about how we do that and why it works for us. And I'm hoping that you can take away from that things that you can plug back into your own work environment or your own family, whether you work for somebody or not. So we work 4 days a week. And that is a 32-hour week, so we don't work 4/10s. We work Monday to Thursday, 9 to 6 p.m. And the office is totally closed on Friday. We do have some customer support that kind of rotates how they work. So we've been doing this since 2006. So this isn't like a new thing. And now we're up to, we don't have managers either. So we got up to 50 people, and then the shit started hitting the fan. People started acting all political and backstabby and weird. And so we thought, how do we change that? Well, let's try removing the managers. So we did that, and now we're at 72 people. We have 73,000 students, and it's still working. So talk a little bit about how we do that so that maybe you guys can take that away and try to plug that back into your environment. So how many of you here have a boss or you report to somebody? That's probably like 80% of you. How many run your own company or can control your life completely? I know your employees can't control your life, but okay, cool. So the other weird thing is that we've managed to be successful. And I don't say this pridefully, but just as an example of we're not kind of a little tiny company that is somehow not working very much. We did $1 million last month. So it kind of shows you like you can actually grow and build a meaningful company, both in size and revenue, and still work less and be happier. So this is a quote that I had said recently in an interview, and I think this is, I find this true. In every company that I've been a manager in, it's almost as if the more we manage, the more people act like children. And now I'm a dad and I have kids. So I can see how this dynamic ends up happening at work. And in case you can't read it, it says, the managers start acting like parents and the people they're managing start acting like children. And what we thought is we should treat people like adults at work. We can all manage our own lives every day. You know, we vote, we take care of our kids, we have them, we wash ourselves, we feed ourselves, you know, we make important decisions about how we drive, and we do all these important things, but then at work, for some reason, our managers act as if we can't make good decisions, important decisions, strategic decisions. And I don't know why this has happened. It's some sort of anthropological phenomena, you know, that we've ended up in managers and managed. But I don't think it has to be like that. And at Treehouse, we seem to be proving that it's possible not to do that. We're not the only company. There's Gore Associates, who has 9,000 employees, and they do a couple billion a year in revenue. They haven't had managers since 1947. They have one CEO, and that's it. And then there's some newer companies, you know, like Valve, who supposedly do this, and GitHub, although I don't know how well it's working in GitHub. But there's some other companies trying it. But I'm going to talk you through the tools and show you how we actually do it, because I don't think it's really fair for me to go, we don't have managers, and you know, we only work 4 days a week. Okay. You know, so we're going to actually show you some stuff. But the bigger question is, why do we do this? And the reason for me is it's because I can spend more time with the people I love. And Jeff talked about this yesterday in the first talk about, you know, why do we do what we do and why are we successful? And it's not because of the work, it's because of the people around us. So this is Devin, my 3-year-old, and Jackson, my 6-year-old. And on Fridays, I do things like this. I spend time with my kids, I hang out with my wife. Not working 40 hours a week or 50 or 60 means that I actually get to spend time with the people I love. So at Treehouse, we have 50% more free time than everybody else. We have 3-day weekends every week. And it allows this. Things like, you know, hanging out with my wife, running around the beach, seeing weird dinosaurs in the desert, and things like that. I mean, this is not bullshit, you know, Facebook post stuff. Like, this is actually happening. And I want you to walk away from this and know that it's possible this could happen to you too. This is Devin, my 3-year-old, and I'm just going to play a little clip. Hopefully it will play.
Hi, Devin. You are 2, gonna be 3. Can you tell me more about Dinosaur Scary, please?
Of course, I like Dinosaur Scary.
Who's your favorite character?
I know.
Godzilla?
I like Godzilla.
What about Transformers?
I like Transformers, Daddy.
You do?
Yes.
What do we do today? Do you remember?
Mommy, I like to watch Transformers, Mommy.
Did we go to the beach today?
Of course, I like to go to the beach.
Who did we go to the beach with?
Who?
So, it goes on, and it's painfully cute, but probably only to me because it's my kid. So, I won't torture you too long. But the point is, like, these are real moments, and they're way more fucking real than what I do at work. I love Treehouse. I want Treehouse on my grave, right? But that is real, right? And Devin's going to die someday. I'm going to die someday. And so we only have a limited amount of time, you know? So it's really precious. So how do we do it? Well, there's a couple things that we think, and this is one of them, right? Email is fucking stupid, right? It takes up our life. We do it all the time. It rules your life. So at Treehouse, we just don't do it. We basically say we ban email internally. So then the basic rule is this. So if you need to communicate, I'll show you how we do it, but we don't do email. And it works. It's amazing. I get about 10 emails a day. They're all from external people like Drew bothering me about the conference. But internally, we don't do any of that. So this frees up a huge amount of time. So if we're going to work 4 days a week and we don't have managers, then you have to remove a lot of this distraction, right? So email's one of them. And I'll explain how we do that in a minute. Other things, we work from home, a lot of us. So this is one of our people working from home. No, it's not really. And the point there is, hey, we let people live their lives. So if you work better from home, or if you work better from a coffee shop, or from your mom's house, or whatever, you just do that. And you don't ask anybody for permission. You don't schedule with anybody. You just do what you got to do. You know, the other week, I called my CFO, and he was in California for some reason. I'm like, oh, you're hanging out with your mom. That's cool. You know, and the point is we let people do what they think is right, and we trust them to get their work done. And this mostly works. I mean, I've talked to some of you about a remote culture, and there's definitely drawbacks. You know, there's less fidelity when you talk to people. There's less, I mean, it's harder. But in general, it works for us. So that's basically the premise of how we do this. So we do less email. We let people work from where they want to work. Now I'm gonna show you the actual tools that we use internally to make all this possible. Now, I care very much about design, so I apologize for the look of this interface I'm about to show you. So this is an internal tool we built called Flow. And what this is basically a simple project management tool. So what we do is you go in and you create a project, and you basically say, okay, what focus area is this in? Like, you know, is it community? Is it marketing? Is it education? Is it ops? Is it, you know, where does it fit in the company? What is the goal of it? So you usually write out a pretty big goal. You know, what am I trying to do here? So this particular project was leaderboards. So we just launched leaderboards on Treehouse so you can see how you rank among other students. So Jeremy, one of our designers, proposed this project. And he wrote out some pretty good detailed goals about it. And then I'll scroll down the page. This is the bottom of that page. You enter a simple requirement for measuring success. You know, how do we know if this thing succeeded or not? What is it? And then you add people to the team. Now, here we have two people that have already joined, Jeremy and Amy. But when you launch the project, those roles are not filled. So they basically, you say, well, in order to do leaderboards, I need a designer and developer. And then you propose the project. And then an email sent out to the whole company at the end of the day. This is one of the rare times we use email. It's basically a digest of all the projects that have been proposed that day. And then if you see a project that you think you can help with or you're excited about and you have time to do, then you click on the link and then you click join. So you basically sign yourself up for projects. And then once all those project positions are filled, then someone can click start. and then the project just starts. And then when you click start, you have to choose an estimated completion date. So all this happens without any input from me as the CEO. I don't sign off any projects that start. The way that projects start is that people get enough buy-in to make them happen, and then they click start. So it's completely self-organizing. And that's the basic project unit at Treehouse. And you can do, a project can be anything from, you know, build a leaderboard to paint the walls of the office, you know, to hire a new teacher. You know, it can really be any unit of work that takes you longer than a couple of hours to do. And the way that people know what projects to launch is, my co-founder and I have created a very large Google Doc that explains the future and vision of Treehouse. So where are we going? What are we doing? You know, how do all the pieces fit together? And then people can look at that and then say, cool, I wanna tackle this part of that vision and make it happen. And then, so they self-organize around that. And that seems to be working pretty well for us. So I forgot to say this at the beginning. So I would like you guys to interrupt me with questions. I'm not gonna do questions at the end. So, just a minute. Not yet, don't interrupt me yet. And what I'm gonna do is everyone who asks a question, we're gonna put your name in a little pot, and then I'll draw it out and then give probably like five of you 1 year Treehouse accounts. So it's worth $250, so ask the questions. So interrupt me, ask a lot of questions, and then we'll go from there. Yes? Yep. So what happens if you don't get people to sign up to a project? It basically dies. So it's just like any other, you know, we're like any other company. We have too many ideas and not enough people. So, you know, remember when we had 5 people, we're like, if we just had another designer, you know, we could do everything. You know, now we have 10 designers and 20 developers and we still can't do everything. So I think stuff just dies. And I actually like the fact that it's not, you know, me as the CEO deciding which projects die and which ones live. You know, it's down to whether people think it's a good idea, whether they can be effective or not. So saw a question all the way over there.
Yeah, how do you handle projects that no one wants to do?
So how do we handle projects no one wants to do? It's really weird. This is the whole treat people like adults thing. People do those things. So there's really shitty projects that no one wants to do, like back up our video, right? It's terrible, it's boring, you know, it's mind, you know, numbingly boring, but people just do it. And I don't know why. Other than they are acting like adults. They know that if we don't do stuff like that, Treehouse could die, right? And no one wants the company to die. So there's like this weird thing where people do what it takes. And I mean, there's some things we notice like, well, this isn't happening. No one's doing that. You know, and we sometimes catch those things and say, hey, who wants to do that? And somebody volunteers. So, and I'm not gonna remember who asked questions, who didn't. So basically, just be honest and then let me know at the end. So how about, in there in the black shirt. Yep, you with the glasses.
So when, that's more of a business question. When you started Treehouse, was Code School, and businesses like Code School, were they around?
Yeah. So what were our competitors like when we launched? We launched in 2010, about the same time Code Academy launched, before Code School launched. But you know, we're all kind of racing against each other, you know, trying to kill each other. It's fun. So.
I have a question. The new manager thing, did you do that at the previous companies too? When you started that at Treehouse?
So the question is, did I do no managers at previous companies? No, Treehouse is the first one. And we only did this a year ago. So we got to 50 people and you know, just started seeing people act like children. Smart, talented, driven people. You know, even when, and it was mind-blowing because we work a 4-day week. You know, we have a mission that matters. You know, we pay people really well. We, you know, we do all these amazing things. So why are people, you know, bitching about stuff or, you know, saying they can't do things or complaining? And what we realized, oh, it's because we have the structure over them. So, or I'll do a couple more and then I'll move on. How about here in the glasses? Sure, so have I written about it? Yeah, I've written a pretty extensive blog post series on my blog, ryancarson.com. So if you go there, I've written about 6 posts that dig in pretty much in detail. So yes. Yep. So the question is, do we have a full HR department with support? We use a company called Trinet, and they basically do outsourced HR. And you basically pay $100 per person, and they take care of everything. It's amazing. So I would highly recommend them. I don't make any money saying that. They're just really good. They basically make sure, you know, all of your legality is ticked with all of your employees, that you're, you know, basically running everything completely legal. All right, one more question. Back in the blue. How do we budget and prioritize? Good question. So we have the big Google Doc that says basically this is the vision, and it's pretty specific. You know, it says, okay, you know, we have Workspaces right now, which is that tool that you code in. You know, next up, we need to add this support to that. So Alan and I, my co-founder, are pretty granular about the priority things need to happen in. And we only started being more specific about priorities like 3 weeks ago, because what we found is, even though people are driven and smart, they find it pretty hard to coordinate across the company and say, you know, okay, you know, how does this priority fit into this? And so people do need direction on that. And it's not because they're not smart enough, it's just that it's actually physically hard to coordinate among people. And then budgeting, we're not a capital expenditure intensive company. You know, we basically don't have physical things that we make. So most of the budgeting doesn't really happen that way. It's, you know, a good example though would be hiring. Like, oh, we need to hire somebody, that's pretty expensive. So people basically say, hey, we can't seem to get enough content out for this course. You know, we need to hire another teacher. And then they basically, you know, just tell me and Alan that, and then we go, yep, we agree, and then it's signed off. So, cool, good questions, you guys. Let me move on a little bit more, and then you guys can fire at me some other questions. This is not exactly the right place for this, but this is one of my favorite animated GIFs. So digging in more into the flow tool. So I showed you before the overview section, and now I'm showing you the discussion section. So this is how we get rid of email. So basically, you know, most of your communication in your company, in our company, is around a project. You know, when I have something to say, it's related to something we're trying to do. And the problem with email is, you know, people get CC'd on stuff or BCC'd, and then you can't get off the copy, or you're not on it. Like, the wrong people are hearing about stuff, and it's just doesn't work, right? So with this is just a simple forum, basically. You post a topic, but the nice thing is that only people on the project get emailed about this. And it's, you don't get emailed to respond an email, it's more of a notification like, hey, someone's talking about a project that you care about, right? So if you want to interact, then you go back to Flow and you interact. So the idea is it's the whole model is kind of a pull model. Like, if you want to interact and pull information, you go to the project page, right? Then instead of having the information pushed at you. And, you know, so I was saying things like, we launched a leaderboard, and I kind of said, hey, you know, should we expose this more? Like, it's kind of hidden in the UI. You know, should we do that? And then, you know, people can discuss that here. And the nice thing is all the communication is physically held here instead of buried in people's inboxes, right? Because the other problem with email is it's private. You know, if I actually want to see the history of communication on a project so that I can understand what's happening, if it's an email, that's impossible, right? But here, if I care about a project and I don't know what's going on, I can just go read for about 30 minutes and figure it all out instead of, you know, tapping someone's shoulder and saying, what's happening with your project? Which is really annoying, isn't it? You know, and that cuts down a lot of unnecessary communication as well. So. And then, you know, we have this is automated, this project's overdue. And Flow Robot said that. And basically, as soon as a project gets overdue, it posts a discussion, and then whoever's working on it has to explain, like, why it's overdue, what's going on. So that seems to work pretty well. You guys can ask more questions if you want. Okay.
How do you know when a project is done? Like, you say a word, then it seems like they might
When's it done? Yeah, how do we know when it's done? Well, one, there's a couple ways we do with that. So let's see. Okay, so what we do is called status updates. So every day, the only thing that you're required to do at Treehouse is post a status update for each project that you work on. And it's kind of a tweet type length, you know, and you go in and say, you know, like Jeremy posted, planning to ship today, he marked it as 100% complete. So whenever you mark a status, there's a dropdown that says, how complete are you with your project? But how complete is your part of this project? You know, and that can be anywhere from 0% to 100%. And then what might happen is, say Jeremy was ready to ship, he's the designer, he marks 100% complete, but say the developer is still wiring things up, she may say, oh, you know, I'm only about 60% done. Or say, let's say 50%, because I can do that math. So say, you know, Jeremy says he's 100%, Amy says she's 50%, so the project will say it's 75% done. So it just averages everyone's completion. So it kind of gives you this really top level view of like, how complete is this thing? It's not exact, but it gives you some idea. Let me go backwards. So eventually, this is the average of the whole project, and then you can mark it as complete. So at that point, the project is complete, but sometimes you still have discussion about it, like I did. And then what people might do is spin up another project, like, okay, let's iterate on the leaderboard. And that happens a lot. So we find that we have usually three infinite stages for a project, but typically you have a project that is just research what this project should be. That's a project, you know, and people will say, well, I'm gonna spend some time figuring out what this is, how it works, and then I'm gonna mark that complete, and then I'm gonna propose a project to actually do the MVP, and then once I do the MVP and ship it, then I'm gonna start iterating. You know, at that point, you may have infinite iterations on the project, so. Cool. So how do we keep the site consistent? Yeah, visually, user experience-wise, all that. The designers, so we have focus areas. So focus areas are like marketing, education, ops, things like that. But each focus area will have job roles cut through it. So you'll have designers, developers, you know, doers, we call them, you know. And so you have job role teams, and like designers are a job role, and they have a HipChat room, which I'll show you in a minute, and they just talk all the time. They talk, they talk too much. I'm not annoyed by that at all, no. It's just this thing, like they figure it out, and actually we use Envision and we love it. I'm not being paid to say that, by the way. Envision is great, it's a good tool that we use for people to they'll say, okay, here's something I'm designing, and then the designers will descend upon it, you know, and say, well, that button is a bit inconsistent, like that's not the style of button we use, or this is weird, or that's not the right color. And so it kind of happens organically.
And
Nope, it all happens online. So we're distributed, I think I said that. We, you know, half of us work from home, and a lot of those are designers and developers. So the way we deal with that, and this is one thing we learned, is that we do have to have physical meetings at least once a year. Without the physical meetings, people start to fall apart. They start treating each other, you know, not as nicely. They don't gel. It's a bit like last night. You get drunk with somebody and you feel closer to them, right? So we get the whole team together and get really drunk once a year. And it's amazing what that will do, right? So that kind of thing keeps people human, and then the coordination across, you know, things like Envision and HipChat keeps them coordinated. So let me dance real quick. Sorry. So this is a thread. This is like, you know, the actual discussion, and we use Markdown on that so you can, you know, post links and do all sorts of stuff, which is really useful. And this is a really powerful, this is necessary if you don't have managers. This idea of I need to be able to go into a project and understand what happened and what's happening, because the information isn't held within one person's brain. So I have to be able to go in and read through what's happening. That works pretty well. And this is HipChat. I think I've seen tons of people using HipChat. So you know, it's like Slack or anything else. And basically, it's just a big chat tool. And we have rooms, which you can't see because it's too dark. But those rooms, like we have a room for each focus area, education, mobile, side ops, support, video production, community. And then you can have one-on-one chats with people. So I'm chatting with Jill, my wife, actually, and then Marshall, who builds our iOS app. And then we have an exec chatter room where me and my co-founder and my CFO chat. And then we have other rooms. And basically, you know, you just dip into these rooms as you have stuff to say or want to understand what's happening. And that works pretty well. And then this also has video chat now, so occasionally we'll fire up a video chat. So this, you know, and in the general room, which is what you're seeing, there's a lot of fun stuff happening, tons of anime GIFs and weird stuff happening in it. I think it makes up for some of the humanness that you lack when you're distributed. So that works pretty well for us. Yeah?